Dear colleagues, compared to nodular goiter, the role of ultrasound is not so evident in Graves' disease. Nevertheless, a recent study demonstrated that over 90% of endocrinologists used ultrasound in the diagnostic workup of Graves' disease. A diffuse hypoechogenicity with a characteristic extremely increased vascularity in a severely hyperthyroid patient is itself diagnostic of Graves' hyperthyroidism. If the endocrinologist performs ultrasound him or herself, the performance can shorten the time to start adequate treatment in mild or moderate forms of hyperthyroidism. In obvious situations, for example in patients with thyroid-associated orbitopathy, the other two rows of ultrasound come to the fore. Graves' disease is characterized by a frequent, more than 50% risk of a later relapse. One of the most important prognostic factors is the size of the thyroid. As a rule of thumb, in a goiter exceeding 50 ml, the chance of recurrence is very likely, and such patients are candidates of definitive therapy as early as the first onset of hyperthyroidism. The next role is the recognition of a coexistent nodule. A repeat ultrasound can be justified later in the course of the disease, either in 6 months or before the planned completion of thyrostatic therapy. We have two reasons for a repeat ultrasound. The first, that ultrasound may contribute to the decision whether to stop or continue the medical treatment. A permanent hypoechogenicity consistent with high TSAB levels is an unfavorable prognostic signal. The other reason is the recognition of a hypoechic nodule, which was masked by diffuse hypoechogenicity in the first study. Occasionally, a repeat ultrasound may have a role in clarifying discrete hypoechoic lesions seen at first exam. In contrast to lymphocytic thyroiditis, the ultrasound pattern changes significantly in almost every patient within 6 to 12 months, and in case of doubt, this can help to decide whether what we have seen is a true nodule or just a more active foci of the underlying autoimmune process. A detailed differential diagnostic of hyperthyroid states is far beyond the scope of this course. Nevertheless, a brief summary is given in the manual. Here I present some aspects. The possible causes of hyperthyroidism are enlisted in the table. In the lower four cases, it has in subacute thyroiditis, iatrogenic forms or nodule-related hyperthyroidism are relatively easy to diagnose. In three of them, ultrasound has important role. The real differential diagnostic issue arises in those mild or moderate forms of hyperthyroidism where neither nodule or nodules responsible for the hyperthyroidism nor pathognomic eye symptoms of Graves' disease are present. This chart gives an approach to the differentiation of hyperthyroid states. The starting point is the most commonly occurring situation. We meet a patient who was referred for evaluation of hyperthyroidism. Except for function tests, no other tests are necessary. A simple clinical examination, inspection, and a short interrogation can clearly clarify a great proportion of cases. If the endocrinologist performs the ultrasound himself or herself, the cause of another significant part of the overactivity becomes clear even at the same appearance. These are the nodular forms. As has been mentioned, the real differential diagnostic problem arises in mild or moderate forms of hyperthyroidism, which cause was not revealed by the former steps. There are three characteristic features of Graves' hyperthyroidism. The thyroid is hypoechoic, the vascularity is increased, and the thyroid is enlarged. Compared to lymphocytic thyroiditis, diffuse hypoechogenicity is significantly more frequent, while focal hypoechogenicity is significantly rarer in Graves' disease. The almost pathognomic vascular inferno can be found in around a quarter of patients, typically in those who present with severe degree of hyperthyroidism. These two examples are almost itself diagnostic of Graves' disease. The left patient has a moderately hyperechoic, while the right has a minimally hyperechoic thyroid, and both present with extremely increased thyroid vascularity. There are several more hyperechoic areas in the left case, but these should not cause differential diagnostic issue. This patient presented with an FT4 level of above 50 picomole per liter, which corresponds to a moderate degree of hyperthyroidism. The vascularity is increased, but not of an extreme level. During the course of Graves' disease, the ultrasound pattern gradually normalizes, but there is a huge individual difference in the rate of this process. A full normalization of ultrasound occurs in less than half of the patients. Minimal degree of hypoechogenicity has no relevance, but the permanent hypoechogenicity is clearly a bad prognostic factor. The left images were recorded at the onset of a not severe degree of hyperthyroidism. The thyroid was hypoechoic and the vascularity was a bit increased. At the time of discontinuation of thyrostatic therapy, the degree of hypoechogenicity has significantly decreased, while the lobe became avascular. This case illustrates another phenomenon. During the thyrostatic therapy, temporary hypothyroidism has developed. In such events, the thyroid gets enlarged and more hyperechoic. If we compare the images recorded at the first and the last exam, images in the first and third column, a slight decrease in echogenicity index and a more pronounced change in vascularity can be observed. Finally, some considerations about nodules and Graves' disease. Although focal hypoechogenicity is not an infrequent finding in Graves' disease, this form causes much less concern than in lymphocytic thyroiditis. Not only the occurrence is lower, but the size of hyperechoic areas tends to be smaller. And the main difference between the two diseases is that in the case of Graves' disease, the pattern changes relatively quickly, within months, while in the case of lymphocytic thyroiditis, it is extremely stable over several decades. While in the case of lymphocytic thyroiditis, it is extremely stable over several decades. So, if we have any doubt about the origin of a discrete hyperechoic lesion, a repeat examination and the comparison of the ultrasound usually resolves the issue. This change in the basic echo pattern is also of great help to reveal hypoechoic nodules, which were covered by the diffuse hypoechogenicity at the onset of hyperthyroidism. We regularly perform ultrasound when treatment is scheduled to stop. It is not primarily to detect previously unrecognized nodules, but to examine the echogenicity of the thyroid gland. The latter, as mentioned previously, is a prognostic sign. Nevertheless, the repeat ultrasound serves also the other purpose, to reveal previously undetected hypoechoic nodule. The left images were recorded at the onset of hyperthyroidism, while the right ones did 17 months later when the patient still received thyrostatic therapy. If we compare the images of the right lobe, a significant decrease in hypoechogenicity index can be detected. The left lobe was suspicious having a nodule at the first exam. The situation became more evident at the other examination. A large hyperechoic nodule occupies almost the entire section. This nodule proved to be a papillary cancer. To summarize, there are some well-defined reasons why most endocrinologists perform ultrasound for hyperthyroidism. The ultrasound is one of the important tools in the differential diagnostics. In clear Graves' disease, the determination of thyroid size is a prognostic signal. A repeat ultrasound later in the course is both of prognostic and of diagnostic importance. If the endocrinologist performs the ultrasound, it will save time for himself or herself and also for the patient. Thank you very much for your attention.